Flip-flops and latches are among the most important building blocks of digital electronics. They allow us to digitally save states, highs or lows, ones or zeros, and therefore set the foundation for most of our digital world. By combining millions of latches and flip-flops, we can store data, build state machines or processing units. So, how do these flip-flops work? What is the difference between them? Which types are available? And what else do we have to consider when using flip-flops? Flip-flops are so-called bistable multivibrators and have, as their name suggests, two stable states, usually high and low, with respect to the supply voltages. They can remain in these states for an arbitrarily long time. Therefore, these are suited for saving information by either being in one or the other state. We cover monostable and astable multivibrators in our other videos. In another video, we derive the possible implementation of a D-latch by using NAND gates and inverters. Now, we want to implement the D-latch in a different way. Again, we have two inverters that we can put into a loop, and two switches that are controlled by a clock C. If C is high, we feed the input D to the output Q. If C is low, the switch at the input D is open, and the inverters are in a loop, saving the old state. Again, we have the functionality of a D-latch. Now we can take two of these D-latches and put them one after the other, with opposite clock signals. Let us again examine that structure and see what happens. If C is low, then the master, which is the first D-latch, keeps its former state, and the slave, the second D-latch, is transparent. So it simply feeds the input to the output. If the clock signal switches from low to high, the slave is separated from the master and the slave's inverters are put into a loop. The slave still keeps the last output of the master. As long as the clock signal is high, the master remains transparent, so QM, the output of the master, equals D, and the slave keeps the last output, so Q equals Q. When the clock signal goes from high to low, the master saves the last value of D, so QM equals D, and the slave becomes transparent, which means Q equals QM equals D. With that, we have built a so-called master-slave D flip-flop that is triggered on negative clock edges. There is a lot of debate going on in the electronics industry regarding the terms master and slave. But until now, manufacturers have not yet been able to agree on a different, uniform name. We will therefore stick to these names, as they appear in almost all current datasheets. Although the two terms latch and flip-flops are sometimes mixed up, there is a difference in between them. A latch always reacts to a new level as soon as it is presented to the input. In contrast, a flip-flop reacts to an edge. A flip-flop is therefore also referred to as edge-triggered. With the developed D flip-flop structure, we need to pay attention to timing. If the timing of the clock is not right, it could happen that both master and slave are transparent at the same time, as all switches could be turned on. With the use of a few inverters and an SR latch, we can create a non-overlapping clock signal for a master-slave D flip-flop to avoid the simultaneous transparent state of master and slave. Furthermore, there are also other timing constraints that have to be met for a master-slave D flip-flop. First, a master-slave D flip-flop is edge-triggered. It is therefore important that the rise and fall time of the clock signal fulfill certain criteria. If the level of the clock signal changes too slow, it can cause uncertainties in timing. Therefore, most flip-flops state a maximum rise and fall time. Second, to guarantee a valid state change, the data signal has to be present at the inputs long enough before the edge of the clock occurs. This is called setup time. And the data signal must also be valid a certain time after the edge of clock as well. This is called hold time. Now let's build another type of flip-flops, a JK flip-flop, that should act similar to a set-reset latch that we present in one of our other videos. We basically want to have this truth table. If J and K are low, the output should remain the same. If K is set, the output should be reset. If J is set, the output should be set. And if K and J are set, the output should be toggled. As an aid, we can think of the words jump for J as the output jumps to high, and kill for K as the output goes to zero. We can now build such a JK flip-flop by using a D flip-flop and some logic gates. But how can we do so? Let us have a look at all possible input combinations consisting of J, K, and the output Qn. We then calculate the output Qn plus 1. This Qn plus 1 is equal to Dn, the input of the D flip-flop. By this, we can derive a logic function for Dn, which is J and not Q, or not K and Q. We can build this circuit by using two AND gates, one OR gate, and one inverter. By that, we have developed a JK flip-flop. When we have a JK flip-flop, we can create a toggle flip-flop by simply connecting both inputs, J and K, to the same signal. This reduces the truth table to two rows. If T is low, the output remains the same. If T is high, the output is toggled at the clock edge. We can use this T flip-flop, for example, for dividing frequencies by applying the clock signal to the clock input and keeping T always high. This finishes our video on flip-flops. We have developed D, JK, and T flip-flops. We talked about the differences between latches, which are state-triggered, and flip-flops, which are edge-triggered, and about timing constraints. In addition to digital bistable multivibrators, there are also analog bistable multivibrators, such as Schmitt triggers. But we deal with Schmitt triggers in a separate video. Furthermore, we will also deal with monostable and astable multivibrators in one of our other videos. I'm Dominik with the Institute of Electronics. We hope you have learned something today, but anyway, thanks for watching.